identify a specific genetic type of, say, a person that lived somewhere at some time in the past. And we can take slices of time anywhere that we have samples and associated radiocarbon dates, and then we can see types move across space and time. We have good evidence that the people living in the Southwest today have been there for thousands and thousands of years. The artifacts on the ground and the people's genomes in the region today are telling us the same story. We're onto something. Now, what I want to do is add a temporal component to this, and I'm starting to look at hundreds of human remains and feces, coprolite samples from the region today to take time slices to say what were the genetics of the earliest farmers and what were the genetics of the foragers before them. This is the clean room, ancient DNA lab, and that's where we process all the, we do all the ancient DNA extraction and PCR setup. We leave all our stuff there, we suit up, we go in there. The whole idea is we're protecting the samples from us. We get very little contamination around here because we do this. And so everything in there has not been touched by human hands, right? Only gloved hands, yeah. Okay, so let's go in and show you around. And I got all these, excuse me, artifacts here to show you too. So ancient DNA is when we are able to recover genetic material from things that are no longer living. We principally work with humans, but this can include animals, plants, extinct species, for instance. After death, most of your DNA will degrade very quickly, but it's under certain conditions that DNA preserves for thousands or tens of thousands of years, and that's what we call ancient DNA. I mean, this is one rib from each of something like 280 individuals from a burial mound in California. So another area of my expertise is in the study of ancient feces, or what we call coprolites, and in this drawer here, each of these bags is not an individual, but an individual poop sample. And here we can see this is a box of DNA that's been extracted from some Aztec children. These were some, so the things that we learn about extracting DNA from, say, 2,000-year-old feces or 2,000-year-old bones are directly applicable to the forensic sciences. When you get a full bone or a sample, you need to break it down some way. And a lot of that is done mechanically at the beginning. Tools of the trade, so it's something like a hammer and hacksaw blades, coping saw, which we have somewhere in here, Dremel blades. So what we would normally do is cut off the crown here right under the enamel. So this is where there's a lot of DNA all in the roots. Then take a couple weigh dishes like this, a couple weigh dishes on the top here, and smash. There's very little DNA in the bones, or feces, or any of the samples that we work with, and we can't really do anything with it until we make many, many copies, and that's what the PCR does. In a matter of, say, an hour and a half, we can make hundreds of billions of copies of a piece of DNA that we want to study. Then it's easier to look at. In our pursuit of extracting DNA from coprolites and bones, we are constantly developing methods to allow us to do this better. So as we're thinking about all these problems, all of a sudden new methods develop, and then we propose them to, say, the National Institute of Justice. And if we can improve our ability to look at those samples, it will increase the chance of recovering DNA evidence from, say, forensic remains and connecting people to their loved ones.